as always, it's nice to have you here with us today. Today we celebrate the 15th Sunday in Ordinary Time, and Mass will be celebrated for the repose of the soul of Joan McTighe. Let's begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all, and with your spirit. My brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. Lord Jesus, you came to lead the nations into the peace of God's kingdom. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. You come in word and sacrament to strengthen us in holiness. Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. You will come again in glory with salvation for your people. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you, we give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, heavenly King, O God, almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayers. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Let us pray. O God, who show the light of your truth to those who go astray, so that they may return to the right path, give all who, for the faith they profess, are accounted Christians, the grace to reject whatever is contrary to the name of Christ, and to strive after all that does it honor. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Amos. Amaziah, priest of Bethel, said to Amos, "Off with you, visionary, flee the land of Judah. There earn your bread by prophesying, but never again prophesy in Bethel, for it is the king's sanctuary and a royal temple." Amos answered Amaziah, "I was no prophet. I was a shepherd and a dresser of sycamores. The Lord took me from following the flock and said to me, 'Go, prophesy to my people Israel.'" The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Lord, let us see your kindness and grant us your salvation.
Lord,
let us see your kindness and grant us your salvation. I will hear what God proclaims, the Lord, for he proclaims peace. Near indeed is his salvation to those who fear him, glory dwelling in our land. Lord, let us see your kindness and grant us your salvation. Kindness and truth shall meet, justice and peace shall kiss. Truth shall spring out of the earth, and justice shall look down from heaven. Lord, let us see your kindness and grant us your salvation. The Lord himself will give his benefits. Our land shall yield its increase. Justice shall walk before him and prepare the way of his steps. Lord, let us see your kindness and grant us your salvation. A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Ephesians. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavens, as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, to be holy and without blemish before him. In love, he destined us for adoption to himself through Jesus Christ, in accord with the favor of his will, for the praise and glory of God's grace that he granted us, his beloved. In him, we have redemption by his blood, the forgiveness of transgressions, in accord with the riches of his grace that he lavished upon us. In all wisdom and insight, he has made known to us the mystery of his will in accord with his favor that he set forth in him as a plan for the fullness of times. To sum up all things in Christ, in heaven and on earth. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, 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 alleluia. May the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ enlighten the eyes of our heart, that we may know what is the hope that belongs to our call. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. The Lord be with you and with your spirit. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus summoned the 12 and began to send them out two by two and gave them authority over unclean spirits. He instructed them to take nothing for the journey but a walking stick, no food, no sack, no money in their belts. They were, however, to wear sandals, but not a second tunic. He said to them, "Wherever you enter a house, stay there until you leave. Whatever place does not welcome you or listen to you, leave there and shake the dust of your feet and off your feet in testimony against them." So they went off and preached repentance. The 12 drove out many demons, and they anointed with oil many who were sick and cured them. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. In our first reading and in our gospel today, we've heard the stories of people who were sent. First, we heard that story of Amos, or at least a little bit of the story. Now, Amos was living in the southern kingdom of Judah. He was living up near the northern border, right next to the kingdom of Israel. Now, the kingdom of Israel was a place that had really fallen away from the faith, the Jewish faith, that is, and God said to Amos, "Go up to Israel and there deliver this prophecy." So he went to Bethel and he started talking about the things that were going to happen if the people didn't turn back to God. And that's when Amaziah said, "Hey, go back to Israel, or go back to Judah. We don't need to hear you here." And that's when Amos said, "Look, I'm just a shepherd and a dresser of sycamores." Meaning he took care of sycamore trees. "I wasn't a prophet or a part of any company of prophets, but God told me to come, so I came. God told me to speak, and so I spoke." And that's the way it needs to be. And in the gospel, we hear about the apostles. Now, we know that they were just ordinary men. Most were fishermen. One was a tax collector. They were a rather ordinary bunch. But Jesus sent them out two by two, to proclaim the kingdom. And I always think that that first trip had to be a little bit scary. Jesus actually made it even tougher. He said, don't put any money in your belts. Don't take a cloak or a second tunic or anything like that. In other words, don't prepare. Just go and see what happens. And they did. And great things happened. Wonderful things happened because they were working with and for God, and great things happened through them. But as we look at life, we know that it can be scary sometimes, especially when there's something new. We don't always feel prepared, but we know that there's some good that needs to be done or some ministry that lies before us, and we just don't know how it's going to go. And those are the moments in which we need some encouragement. I remember when I was in the seminary, and one of the things we had to do from time to time was visit the hospital. So I had this hospital ministry, and at the beginning it was rather tough. You know, I found that I was incredibly nervous. The first time I ever visited a patient, I was with this nun named Sister Mary Frederick, and she said, Richard, why don't you give us a prayer? And I said, bless us, O Lord, and these, I guess. I just couldn't think of anything to say. And I was with a lady one day, and she was having some psychological or emotional difficulties. And I remember she said, nobody believes a word I say. And I said, oh, that can't be true. And exactly the wrong thing to say. But that happened. Other times, you know, I was visiting a man who was complaining. Well, he had shingles. And he said, do you want to see? And I said, sure. And he lifted up his gown and wasn't wearing any pants. I said, well, that's nice. But those sort of things happened all the time. I visited a man once who was coughing and coughing and coughing. And I was sitting there talking to him, and they didn't know what was wrong with him. Well, 2 days later, turned out he had tuberculosis. So I had to keep going back to the hospital to get tested to make sure I didn't have tuberculosis. Those things happened. But in the end, it got better and better. In the end, even though there were frustrations and difficulties and some days didn't go as well as others, overall, it worked out very well. And if we think about any good thing we do, it isn't always easy. Sometimes there are fits and starts. Some days are wonderful and some days are rather more difficult. But God calls us to go out there and do the good that needs to be done. And what we can't do is say, oh, I'm not qualified, or oh, that's too much for me, or oh, it might be too difficult, or oh, I'm too scared. When we find some good that needs to be done, when life presents us with an opportunity, we have to give it a try. And just as with those apostles, if we're doing God's work, if we're working for Him and with Him, if we're inviting Him to help us in whatever the work is, whatever the mission is, well, He will be active. And it doesn't mean we'll be perfectly successful, but it means some good will be done because God will be present and active. And that's something we need to think about. But there is one other thing. And that is that it's not just about starting something new. Because most days we don't begin anything new. I mean, tomorrow is going to be a lot like yesterday was, and today is, well, my life is a lot like it was a week ago, and much like it was 2 months before that, and there is a certain repetitive nature to life. I was reading, in preparation for this, all sorts of commentaries on these scriptures and sample sermons that other people had wrote. And one of them made a very interesting point. And that was that it's about getting back into the mission, getting back into whatever it is we're called to day after day after day. That's where God is pushing us to go. That's where God is hoping we'll go. And that's where sometimes the difficulty arises. And if you think about it, that makes a great deal of sense. I had a little vocation crisis several years ago, and it was that there was, well, bad things in the news about the priesthood. There were certain difficulties in my life. There were certain difficulties in the ministry. And I remember the thought crossed my mind, maybe I shouldn't be a priest anymore. And it didn't just cross my mind. It kept crossing it again and again, and I was thinking about it. Well, I remembered back to when I was a young priest and I was in this conference with a bunch of other young priests, and one of them stood up at one point and said, "Guys, we're called to be heroic." And that always struck with me, because I never thought of it that way. You don't think of priests as being heroes. You don't think of regular people as being heroes most of the time. Every once in a while, yes, a policeman or a fireman or a soldier or somebody might do something heroic, but we don't think of ourselves generally as being heroic. But I was thinking about that as I was going through that tough time, and I realized that you don't need to be heroic when everything's easy, but God's calling us to be heroes when times are tough. That's where heroes are made. And so, okay, I might be sad about things, and I might be angry about things, and I might be feeling frustration, but what does the heroic person do? Sticks with it, keeps trying, works through the tough times, and gets to the good time that comes after. That's what we need to make sure we think about. Because I know that sometimes married couples don't wake up happy. I know that sometimes you can sit there and say, "Ugh, there's that person again, talking and talking and talking." I know that it can be tough. I know that it can be tough to be a parent. I know that, for instance, March, April, May, it gets to be a little bit tough to be a teacher. I know that students get tired of coming to school day after day. I know that life can be repetitive. Life can sometimes be frustrating. Life can be somewhat boring, no matter what line of work we're in or no matter what our vocation is. But what we need to understand is, in those difficult moments, God still has a plan. God still has needs for us. And even though we might face resistance or frustration, we have to be like the prophet Amos and say, "Hey, God has called me to do this. I need to do it. God has asked me to come here, and so I came. God has asked me to speak, and so I've spoken." That's the way it needs to be with each one of us, because God does have hopes and plans and dreams for us, and it won't always be wonderfully easy. But He's asking us to be persistent in living this Christian life, persistent in serving the people He has placed around us, persistent in being the good Christians, the good husbands, the good wives, the good parents, the good children, good whatever it is He has called us to be. And I think as we read these readings and think about the call, we need to think about it's not just a call to act once, but it's a call to act day after day to make the lives of the people around us better, happier, and holier, to serve Him, and to be the good witnesses, the good Christians, the good servants that we're called to be. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Now let us profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through Him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, He came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake He was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and His kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Trusting that God will provide all that we need to carry out His will, let us bring our concerns to Him. For the Church, may the Lord guide and strengthen our leaders as they share the good news through their words and service. We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. For first responders, may they have the protection of St. Michael as they serve, protect, and heal. We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. For all who suffer from any form of addiction, may the Holy Spirit guide them on the path of recovery and give them strength. We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. And for the youth in this faith community, may they grow ever deeper in their faith and in their desire for the Lord. We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. And for Joan McTighe, for whom this Mass is being offered, and for all those who have died, may they be received in the merciful embrace of our God. We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, receive our petitions and grant all that is pleasing to you. We ask this through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the bread we offer you. Fruit of the earth and work of human hands, it will become for us the bread of life. Blessed be God forever. By the mystery of this water and wine, may we come to share in the divinity of Christ, who has humbled himself to share in our humanity. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands, it will become our spiritual drink. Blessed be God forever. Wash me, O Lord, from my iniquities, and cleanse me from my sins. Pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May the Lord accept a sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church. Look upon the offerings of the church, O Lord, as she makes her prayer to you, and grant that, when consumed by those who believe, they may bring ever greater holiness through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you and with your spirit. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and just. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For by his birth he brought renewal to humanity's fallen state, and by his suffering canceled out our sins. By his rising from the dead he has opened the way to eternal life, and by ascending to you, O Father, he has unlocked the gates of heaven. And so, with the company of angels and saints, we offer the hymn of your praise as without end we acclaim. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith. Save us, Savior of the world, for by your cross and resurrection you have set us free. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church, spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope, and Lawrence our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember your servant, Joan McTighe, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that she, who was united with your Son in a death like his, may also be one with him in his resurrection. Remember also our brothers and sisters, who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen. At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always, and with your spirit. Now let us offer each other a sign of peace. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Since we cannot have regular communion, please recite with me this prayer so that we may have spiritual communion together. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot receive you at this moment sacramentally, Come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen. Let us pray. Having consumed these gifts, we pray, O Lord, that by our participation in this mystery, its saving effects upon us may grow through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you and with your spirit. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go forth, the Mass is ended. Thanks be to God. Well, thank you, as always, for being here with us today. Jerry gave me a list of a lot of the comments and suggestions you've had over the last several months, and they were very flattering, so thank you for that, and quite helpful. Again, so thank you for your support. Now, I know that over the past few months, people have written to me a few times and asked how they could donate online, and it took us a while to get that set up. So finally, now if you look at the parish website, there is a button that says donate, and the button is now active. I used it yesterday myself, so I don't have to use my church envelopes anymore. But anyway, you can make a one-time donation, you can make something that takes place periodically, whatever you like. You don't have to give anything, but if you'd like to, the option is there. So thank you for your support, and I hope you have a good day and a good week.
See the face of God and live.